students, hope that you are all studying at home using the study materials and the videos sent by the school. Keep learning and prepare for the future examination. The situation will not always remain same. We could not begin our new academic session due to COVID-19, but the school is being sent in videos and the study materials from the beginning. So please go to the YouTube channel of Dinobili Chandrapura and the websites and obtain all the study materials and the videos which are sent by the school. And many are worried about their first semester portion, but enough portions are sent by the school through to the website and YouTube channel. So please make use of that and keep learning. In class 9, under this branch of study of social science, we learn three subjects. Which are those three subjects? History, civics and geography. We have already finished some of the lessons of history and geography. And in this session, we will discuss civics. In geography, what do you learn? We learn everything about Earth in class 9. We completely study about the structure of the Earth and the internal forces, external forces. The lesson begins with Earth as a planet, then latitudes and longitude, how to locate places, and then seasons, rocks. Then we study about oceans, atmosphere, everything about the Earth in class 9. And about history, we study in ancient Indian history in class 9. In class 6 you have already learned the same portions. The ancient history you have learned in the form of a summary in class 6. Which are those chapters do you remember? Harappan civilization, Vedic age, Buddhism and Jainism, Mauryan empire, Gupta empire, etc. But in class 9 you study the same topic in an elaborate manner. But the studies are very interesting. And now we begin with civics. Children, civics is a subject that is very comprehensive in nature. From monarchy to anarchy, dictatorship to democracy, from struggle to victory. It tells us everything about the evolution of the government and the countries of the world. Causes, consequences, decisions. Decision become part of a country's constitution make the subject civics very interesting. India attained its freedom about 71 years ago. This cherished independence attained by its people through rigorous struggle. The people who India now the largest democracy in the world. The people with variety of religion, caste, creed, etc. India is the largest democratic country in the world. We have a constitution which protects the fundamental rights of the citizen and limits the powers of the government. So, we have a constitution which finds the solution of its citizen at any time, that is 24/7. So, we are going through a fine features of the Indian constitution. So, let us start our journey. The constitution. Do we have any rules in our society? Yes, we do. Do we have any rules in the school? Yes, we have a school diary that mentions all the rules are to be followed by everyone. Similar way, constitution is a great rule book or law book that has to be followed by the government and the people. Constitution is one of the most important document in the world. For another 3-4 years, you 9th standard students would be voting. It can be Lok Sabha election, Rajya Sabha election or Panchayat election. Being a citizen of the country, it is your responsibility that you should know the history of our constitution and the history of our country. So, don't look at this chapter as a boring chapter, but look at it as a first step in the process of education of being responsible citizen. See the definition. Constitution is a comprehensive document containing set of rules according to which the government of a country runs. Now, what do you mean by comprehensive document? Cambria because comprehensive means the lengthiest document. Why we have a lengthiest document? Because India is a country of various religion, customs, and religious caste and creed people. So they need to make separate rules for each sections of the people. At the same time, our frame workers, they have referred important documents while framing the constitution. So they wanted to make our constitution maximum perfect, including all the better points. So that reason our constitution has become the lengthiest and most important document of the world. So it is a comprehensive document. The next important point is that set of rules. Here, what do you mean by set of rules? A country means the government runs according to the set of rules. Now, what that means, it decides, there mentions what are the fundamental rights and duties of the citizen, what are the functions and powers of the government, and how does the government ensure the rights of the citizens, and what are the duties of the citizen, and what are the how the powers of the government is limited. All these things are mentioning in the set of rules. And next is what, according to which the government of a country runs. That means the government of our country runs, the government runs according to the set of rules, which are according to the set of laws which are mentioned in our constitution. And next, we see that structure of the government. Our constitution provides a particular framework to our government. That means our country is taken care by three important organs, and which forms the main structure of the government. So that we can say that our government consists of three important organs. Which are those organs? Legislature, executive, and judiciary. Now, what do you mean by legislature? You must have heard about Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. What do you mean by Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha? That is means a parliament. A parliament consists of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Must have seen the parliament building, isn't it? And next is that executive. Executive consists of president, prime minister, and council of ministers. That means all the important officials comes under the executive. Now, judiciary. Judiciary consists of lower court, district court, high court, and supreme court. So all the courts comes under the judiciary. Now let's see what are their important powers like. Now legislature means what? It is a law making body. What does it mean by law making body? You see that already laws are made by our country, isn't it? The constitution, all the laws are mentioned. Then do we need to make any more laws? Yes, as the time changes, we need to make changes in our constitution. We have to move according to the changes with the society and the situation. So that means any changes or any laws are to be made for the government and the country, and any changes are to be made in the law, and all these are decided by the legislature. That means Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. How these Lok Sabha members are elected? Lok Sabha members are elected directly, and Rajya Sabha members are elected indirectly. You know that suppose in your class, you see, if you are choosing your monitor, so everybody is asked to choose the monitor, do the election, voting. So you directly involved in choosing the monitor. Then after the monitors, then suppose we are need to be chosen a head boy or head girl of a school, then all the monitors together, sometimes if they are called, and they will be asked to choose one person as their, one boy or girl as their head girl and head boy. Now here what happens is that you, the class monitors are directly elected because you children are directly involved in their election, now choosing them. But a head boy and head girl are elected by the children, by whom you are elected. That means your representative, who are your representative, the monitors whom you are chosen in the class directly, and those monitors are involved in the election of what is that, your head boy and head girl. That means here what is it, in the class you made the direct election, and then for head boy and head girl you are involved, but you are not directly involved. Why? Because your representatives
the one who is elected by you are involved in that election.
Our Lok Sabha members are directly elected and Rajya Sabha members are indirectly elected. You understood that how monitors are elected, how head boy and head girl are elected. Similar way, Lok Sabha members are directly elected by the people and Rajya Sabha members are indirectly elected. So they forms, both the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha together forms the legislature, one of the important law making body of the government. Next is that executive. Executive consists of president, prime minister, council of ministers and all other important officials. All these officials together forms the executive. What is their function? And legislature, they forms the law and who brings the law into effect, who carry out the law, and executive, they are responsible for carrying out the law. And next is that judiciary. Judiciary is the guardian of our constitution. Guardian of our constitution means it ensures that law and set of rules and regulations are followed by the citizen and the government, and the fundamental rights of the citizens are ensured or not. So that means judiciary is one of the important organ, consists of High Court and Supreme Court. Now let's see that all these three important organs are interrelated and at the same time they are independent. They are independent but they are interrelated. For example, suppose if you have a joint family, what happens? The grandfather parents comes at the top, followed by your parent, then followed by you. So if there is a proper understanding and supporting each other, what happens? They come into existence a happy atmosphere and a peaceful atmosphere, so that each and every family member can flourish. Similar way, these organs, they are independent and interdependent, and they interdependent, and so that they function together together for the development and betterment of the country and its citizens. Now we have to discuss the enactment of the constitution. So in the year 1946, the cabinet mission came to India. One of the member of cabinet mission, his name is Trafford Cripps. He came in India and he proposed, what was his proposal? You know that we were about to get freedom in the year 1946, because till then we were under the Britishers. We got freedom in the year 1947. So when the British government, they decided to give freedom for India, we Indians have decided that before becoming an independent nation, means as a part of an independent nation, it is very necessary for us to form a constitution for our country. We should have a law book. So that now who will make this constitution? That was the question. So in the year 1946, one of the member of cabinet mission, that is Trafford Cripps, he came in India and he proposed that as the part of the making of constitution, if you want to make a constitution, first of all, you need to make a constituent assembly. In order to take any important decision of a country, you need to have some important people to come together and carry out that work. So here, Constituent Assembly means some of the important members of the country, the people of the country should be chosen and they should be entrusted the responsibility of making the constitution. So those people who are involved in making of the constitution, they are considered as Constituent Assembly. Now, who will be the part of Constituent Assembly? That is the next question. Now, the answer came that, that means we have decided that the members of the Provincial Assembly should be elected as the members of Constituent Assembly. Now, what do you mean by Provincial Assembly here? In India, we have Lok Sabha. Similar way, before the independence, when we were under the Britishers, we never had Lok Sabha. Instead of Lok Sabha, we had Provincial Assembly. That means now we have states, number of states. In those days, instead of states, we had 17 provinces. So the members of these provinces formed the Provincial Assembly, that was equivalent to Lok Sabha. So The election. So this election for the provincial assembly was held in the year 1946 in the month of July. Now, how many members are elected from provinces? 293 members are elected from every provinces, and 93 members are elected from princely states. Here, what do you mean by princely state? During the British period, other than provinces, there were number of princely states which were ruled by very small kings, and no elected members were there. Only the members were chosen, since princes being the head, and members were chosen, and those members, so that's why they say members of the nominated members of princely states, 93 were there. Then commissioner, members of commissioner provinces were there, 4 in number. So all together in the Constituent Assembly included 389 members. So how many members in the Constituent Assembly were elected? 389 members were elected. And now the Constituent Assembly is formed, isn't it? Now this baby steps have started, isn't it? Birth of the baby taken place. Constituent Assembly has taken birth of the Constituent Assembly is being taken place. Now it has to slowly start working. What is the first step? That means first step, all should gather together, and the discussions and the meeting and debate should be held. So who will carry out all this? One president, some head should be there, isn't it? Now for the time being, in order to preside over the meeting, in the first sitting held in the year 9th December 1946, and Dr. Sachidananda Sinha was elected as the he was just chosen in order to preside over the meeting of the first sitting of the Constituent Assembly. It was held in the central hall of the parliament. We have not seen the central hall of the parliament, but Bharat Ratna is being given, and the children and warriors are all felicitated in this central hall of the parliament. So the first sitting of the Constituent Assembly was held in the central hall of the parliament, and it was presided over by Dr. Sachidananda Sinha. There included 389 members at the time of the formation of Constituent Assembly. We discussed that undivided India had 389 members in the Constituent Assembly. Now, what do you mean by the term undivided India? Why should we use the term here? At that point of time, you know that Pakistan was not taken birth. Pakistan and India was a part of a country, single nation. So we use the term undivided India. Why? Because India was not divided. So including both Pakistan and India, all together 389 members were there in the beginning in the Constituent Assembly. Now the next question is that who become the president of the Constituent Assembly? And no president was officially elected. So in the year December 11th 1946, Dr. Rajendra Prasad was officially elected as the president of Constituent Assembly. So when the question comes, who was elected as the president of Constituent Assembly, what you will write? You should write the name of Dr. Rajendra Prasad. Why? Because he was officially elected. Sachidananda Sinha, he was just asked to preside over the meeting, only for the time being. Now, Rajendra Prasad was officially elected as the president of Constituent Assembly. Now, who was the president of the independent India, first president? That also Rajendra Prasad. Now, see, only first sitting is over. We have to travel a long distance to reach to the birth of Constitution, to give the formation of Constitution. Isn't it? So at that point of time, the Muslim League boycotted the Constituent Assembly. Now, why? What was the reason for the Muslim League boycotted the Constituent Assembly? Because they were in the demand of the formation of Pakistan. Since it's quite natural that if they want a separate nation, they want to form a separate Constituent Assembly. So they don't want to be the part of the Constituent Assembly of India. So that is the reason that why the Muslim League boycotted the Constituent Assembly. So now the number of the Constituent Assembly got reduced from 389 to 1999. What was the reason? Because the members of the Muslim League, all the Muslim community, isn't it? Those Muslim League members, they boycotted the Constituent Assembly because they did not want to be the part of the Constituent Assembly of India. Why? Because they wanted to form a separate nation and their Constituent Assembly. Now, at the time of meeting, now only first sitting is held and further meetings, the members, the actual members who were present in the Constituent Assembly were only 284 members. Now, see, between 9th December 1946 to August 14th, 1947, they held 5 sessions of the Constituent Assembly. You see, number of meetings. Now, within this short period of time, 5 sessions were held, or in other words, 5 sittings were held of the Constituent Assembly. See, the procedure of constitution making started in the year 1946, and we formed our constitution in the year 1949. So now we discuss here only between the period of 1946 to 1947, 5 sessions are held. Why? Because it is a big decision that we have to take, isn't it, with the formation of our constitution. That was not an easy process for the framers of the constitution. So so many sessions were held. For example, you see, in India, demonetization taken place. So that was not the decision taken place overnight, isn't it? And before that, many officials, ministers and other dignitaries, they held their meetings and decisions and debates number of times and finally reached into the decision of demonetization, isn't it? So the similar way here also, it was a long process, like so there held number of sitting of the Constituent Assembly, and between 1946 to 1947 there held 5 session of the Constituent Assembly. Now children, we conclude the session here and we continue this the rest of the next point with the next video.